Anjana. Asuranandana Vajajana Ranjana. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Sindhu Dinabandhu Jigakati Gopisha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namo Sute Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jigakati Gopisha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namo Sute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vishwabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vishwabhanu Sute Devi Panamami Hari Piye Pancha Kalpataru Vyasa Kripa Sindhu Vyaiva Chapaditanam Pavane Vyo Vaishnave Vyo Namo Namaha Pancha Kalpataru Vyasa Kripa Sindhu Vyaiva Chapaditanam Pavane Vyo Vaishnave Vyo Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama. Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jai Gauranita, 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 Jai Gauranita, Jai Gauranita. Jai Gauranita, Gauranita. Gauranita, Jai Gauranita. Jaya Jaya Prabhupan, 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 Jaya Prabhupan. Jaya Jaya Prabhupan, Prabhupan. Prabhupada, Jai Prabhupada. Paramahamsa Paravajanka Charyasa Tarasat Sri Shamanis Samangai Sisi Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Ananta Koti Vaishnavinda Ki Namacharya Silhardasa Kurki Parmes of Gosh Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sedaita Gadadhar Shivasada Gaura Bhaktivinda Ki Sri Shivana Govinda Gopinath Shamakunda Radhakunda Giri Govardhan Ki Vrindavan Dham Ki Shrimaya Purnavadip Dham Ki Yamana Maya Ki Ganga Maya Ki Bhakti Deva Ki Samveda Bhaktivinda Ki Tulasi Maharani Ki Sri Sri Gornitai Ki Sri Jagannath Baladev Sabara Devi Ki Sri Sri Radha Landanishwara Ki Sri Giriraj Maharaj Ki Nitai Gaur Premanandi. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Today we are reading from Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Lila, chapter 18, the Lord's visit to Sri Vrindavan. And we're going to read text number 50 to 62. 50 to 62. 62. So there's a lot of text there. Anyway, I'm just going to read the English translation until we get to 62. Text 50. All right, we'll begin. Glorify Lord Chaitanya. Jaya Jaya Sri Chaitanya Jaya Nityananda. Jaya Daita Chanda Jaya Gaura Bhaktivinoda. Text number 50. Bhugarbha Goswami, Sri Jiva Goswami, Sri Adhavacharya, and Govinda Goswami also accompanied Sri Rupa Goswami. Sri Rupa Goswami is going to see the Gopal deity. And so those personalities, these personalities are going to accompany him. Text 51. He was also accompanied by Sri Uddhava Das, Madhava, Sri Gopal Das, and Narayana Das. 52. The great devotee Govinda, Vani Krishna Das, Pundarikaksha, Ishana, and Laghu Haridas also accompanied him. Purport. Laghu Haridas should not be confused with Junior Haridas, who committed suicide at Prayag. Generally, a devotee is called Haridas, and consequently, there are many Haridas. The chief was Thakur Haridas. There was also a Madhyama Haridas. In the Bhakti Ratnakara, sixth wave, there is a list of many of the chief devotees who accompanied Sri Rupa Goswami. And it gives a list. The following Vaishnavas were present with Sri Rupa Goswami: the merciful Sri Gopal Bhatta Goswami, Bhugarbha Goswami, Sri Lokanath Das Goswami, the reservoir of good qualities, Sri Madhava, Sri Paramananda Bhattacharya, Sri Madhu Pandit, whose characteristics are all wonderful, Premi Krishnadas, Krishnadas Brahmachari, Yadava Acharya, the merciful Narayan, Sri Pundarikaksha Goswami, Govinda, Ishana, Sri Govinda, the magnanimous Vani Krishnadas, Sri Uddhava, who occasionally visited Bengal, Dwija Haridas, Krishnadas Kaviraj, Sri Gopal Das, whose body is completely spiritual, Sri Gopala, Madhava, and many others. Text 53. It was with great jubilation that Rupa Goswami visited Lord Gopal, accompanied by all these devotees. 54. After staying at Mathura for 1 month, the Gopal deity returned to his own place and Sri Rupa Goswami returned to Vrindavan. 55. In the course of this story, I have given the description of Lord Gopal's mercy. After seeing the Gopal deity, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Sri Kamyavan. Purport. Kamyavan is mentioned in the Adi Varaha Purana. Chaturdham kamyaka vanam vananam vanam uttamam tatra gotva naravdevi mamaloke mahimyate. Lord Shiva said, the best of all forests is the fourth of these, named Kamyaka, O Goddess Devi, and any person who goes there is eligible to enjoy the glories of my abode. In the Bhakti Ratnakara, the fifth wave, it is also said, E Kamyavane Krishna Lila Manohar Karibe Darshana Stana Kunda Bahutara. Kamyavane yata tirta lekha nahi tara. In this Kamyavan, Krishna performed many enchanting pastimes. Here you will be able to take darshan of many ponds and other transcendental spots. I cannot even describe in writing all the sacred tirthas found at Kamyavan. Text 56. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's touring Vrindavan has been previously described. In the same ecstatic way, he traveled all over Vrindavan. After visiting the places of Krishna's pastimes at Kamyavan, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Nandishwar. While there, he was overwhelmed with ecstatic love. Purport: Nandishwar is the house of Nanda Maharaj. 58. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu bathed in all the celebrated lakes, beginning with Lake Pavana. Thereafter, he climbed a hill and spoke to the people. Purport: The Pavana Sarovara is described in the Mathura Mahatmya. Pavane Sarasi Snatva Krishnam Nandishvare Girao Dristanandam Isodam Cha Sarvabhishtam Avapnuyat. One who bathes in the Pavana Lake by Nandishvara Hill will see Krishna there along with Nanda and Yasoda and will fulfill all of their desires. Text 59. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked, "Are there any deities on top of this hill?" The local people replied, "There are deities on this hill, but they are located within a cave." Text 60. There are a father and mother with well-built bodies, and between them is a very beautiful child who is curved in three places. Text 61. Hearing this, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu became very happy. After excavating the cave, he saw three deities. And 62 is up here. Hare Krishna. Multitasking. Rajendra Rajeshwari Kaila Charana Vandana. Rajendra Rajeshwarira Kaila Charana Vandana. Rajendra Vajeshwarira Kaila Charana Vandana. Premesh Pramaveshe Krishnera Kaila Sarvanga Sparshana. Premaveshe Krishnera Kaila Sarvanga Sparshana. Premaveshe Krishnera Kaila Sarvanga Sparshana. Vrajendra Vrajeshwarira Kaila Charana Vandana. Premaveshe Krishnera Kaila Sarvanga Sparshana. Prabhu's.
Krishna Kaliya Sarvanga Sparshana.
Vraja Indram of the king of Vraja, Ananda Maharaj. Vraja Ishvarira and of the queen of Vraj, Mother Yashoda. Kaila did Charana Vandana, worshipping the lotus feet. Prema Avese, in ecstatic love. Krishnera, of Lord Krishna. Kaila, did. Sarva Anga Sparshana, touching the whole body. Translation. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu offered his respects to Nanda Maharaj and to Mother Yashoda, and with great ecstatic love he touched the body of Lord Krishna. Magarantamananda Shaganansana Shalaka Sakshin Meditamina Tasmashi Gurave Namah Sri Chaitanya Manobisam Stapitamina Bhutale Swan Rupa Kadamayam Dharati Swapadantikam. So this chapter is relating Lord Chaitanya's travels to Vrindavan and his visits to the holy places. And there's not many purports here to speak about, but we'll say something general. That Lord Chaitanya, of course, he's coming as a devotee. And so he's showing how to behave as a devotee and taking pilgrimage to these holy places of Vrindavan. And of course, while there, the Lord was able to find out the place of Radhakund and excavate that, take his bath there. And also, he gave his example when he came to Govardhan. There's a Gopal deity with Govardhan as Krishna himself. And so he showed his example for the devotees how to respect Govardhan Hill. And out of affection for the Lord, the Gopal deity himself came down from the hill so that Lord Chaitanya could have his darshan. So this way, Lord Chaitanya, he's showing us actually how to visit the holy places, how to respect them. And not only that, then also the other acharyas, they also went, a whole group of them together, you can imagine, kind of like our pariyatra. Huh? They went from Vrindavan all the way to Mathura to see the Gopal deity at Mathura. So there's a large group and they went. How long would it take to walk from Vrindavan to Mathura, you suppose? Huh? Half a day? 2 days? 1 day? Has anybody ever done it? Anyway, it's not a short walk, right? So maybe half a day, something like that. So they would have had a nice kirtan party along the way there, one can imagine. Any questions or comments? So what shall we talk about? I'll share with you some of my latest realizations. All these goings on in the world, people are so all the time traveling, or going and protesting. And they obviously, the people, they see something that the leaders don't, or they see the world in different ways. And of course, what this means is that everybody's expressing a different kind of consciousness. That all of us, we say that the world, this is a world of illusion, but it's not just one illusion, but it's many different illusions. In fact, 7 billion different illusions. Each of us has our own particular type of illusion that we're living under, based on our particular contact with the material energies and our own specific desires and attachments. So our desires, our attachments, the way we contact the material energy, imposes on the pure consciousness a clouded or covered consciousness, a covering, a filter, if you will, by which people cannot see things as they are. So everybody's going around in a state of illusion. And this includes even the so-called spiritual people of this world. The religious people are people of different religions. We see they report that some 79% of the people in the UK think that religion has caused a lot of grief and suffering in this world. Of course, that's true to some extent, because actually, as Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati explains, that the demons, that they infiltrate the religious groups and they misdirect them from their original purpose. And so yes, in this way, religion does cause a lot of suffering. Actually, there's what, between, now they say between 20% and 30% of the people in the Western countries, at least, think of themselves as spiritual but not religious. So they want to have some affinity for God, or they have some affinity. They want to know about spiritual life, but they've been discouraged or disappointed by the religious institutions. And so they're looking for God in a different way. So this that we should take advantage of this state of mind, let's say, of the people. And Krishna consciousness, not as a religion, because Prabhupada says, we're not a religion. It's not that, he says, Bhagavad Gita purport, that religion implies faith, and faith may change. And so Krishna consciousness is not a matter of faith, but actually Krishna consciousness is a Prabhupada wrote in one purport, our actual religion is Vanashram Dharma, or the Krishna Tattva. What is the absolute truth? So Krishna consciousness is not, Prabhupada said, we're not interested in converting people from being Christians to become Hindus, but rather we want them to understand what is the absolute truth and to develop their relationship with God. So Krishna consciousness means then that, let's say, by the practice of Krishna consciousness, the an object is to lift this veil of illusion, to free ourselves from this illusion that we're all laboring under. And to do that means that we have to give up our attachments to the way we think things are or they should be. We have to give up our attachments to, or let's say, our fallible soldiers. We take shelter of what Bhagavatam calls fallible soldiers. Fallible soldiers are all the things of this material world in whose association we feel comfortable. Right? So we're accustomed to that. We're conditioned by these things, by family, by our place in society. And in the midst of this, we feel ourselves secure. But actually, all of these things, none of them can actually help us at the time of death or sustain us. And so therefore they're called fallible soldiers. But Christian consciousness, of course, or let's say by the practice of Krishna consciousness, we should be able to let go of these one by one and learn how to depend on Krishna alone, understanding that he is controlling everything and he is directing everything in my life. So we have to learn to see the world in that way. And in that way we become free, then from gradually we become free from these various illusions. Takes some time. It's a gradual process of letting go, of purification, of surrender. And we do this by rendering service to the pure devotees and engaging in the nine processes of devotional service. So gradually as we do that, our understanding, our consciousness becomes clear. Then the next time that we read the Bhagavatam or the Bhagavad Gita, we can understand more. We see things that we didn't see before. And so then our understanding, our realization increases and expands. So like this, it's a stepwise process of purification and increasing realization, more purification and more increasing realization like this, until finally we become free from all of these misunderstandings and can see things as they are. So this is this is where we want to go. Understand that I'm in illusion and I should follow this process carefully so that I can become free from the illusion. Comments or questions? Yeah, actually, where was that? We read that just the other day. It was a little surprising. I'd have to look it up. I can't remember exactly where that was. Because I'm not reading in books. I'm reading on my Kindle. So, you know, if you read a book, you remember what it looks like. But the Kindle, they're all the same. Anyway, I can find that. Yeah, it was kind of surprising. Prabhupada says our actual religion is Vanashram Dharma. Meaning religion. What's religion? Re means to back, legio to connect. So religion means to connect again with God. So that's actually the process of Vanashram Dharma, is to do that, to actually to help us come step by step closer to Krishna. So I'm going to speak about that tonight. I'm giving class Bhagavad Gita. Is it correct tonight? So there's Krishna explains Vanashram Dharma in Bhagavad Gita, chapter 12. So we're going to speak about that and explain that process, that step-by-step process, how we come closer to Krishna, up to the point where this Vanashram Dharma is meant to bring us to the point of being able to practice the principles of Bhakti Yoga. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur in Chaitanya Shikshamrita, he also explains that this is, for those who cannot execute Bhakti Yoga properly, that they must take shelter of Vanashram principles. And this helps them to become purified step by step so that they can then actually begin to practice Krishna consciousness or Bhakti Yoga. So we'll speak more about that tonight. But you're all going away. You're going to some feast somewhere, right? Yeah. Okay, anyway. Yes, Prabhu. Prabhupada answers that in Bhagavad Gita. Prabhupada says, no, it's not a religion, because religion implies the idea of faith, and faith may change. But actually, Krishna consciousness aims at the absolute truth. That truth which is absolutely true for everyone. So, and that doesn't change. It's not relative. So Krishna consciousness is the absolute truth. It's, you know, people, they interpret these things because they're so used to or accustomed to thinking about Christians or Jews or Muslims, and they think like this in terms of religion. So they naturally think of Krishna consciousness as religion because, you know, that's what you people believe, right? So it's like, you know, some people believe this, some people believe that, and you guys, you believe Krishna consciousness. So because their worldview is limited, they have no other way of actually understanding that, because they don't have a concept of absolute truth in their worldview, in their concept of life. So Krishna consciousness, actually, the Prabhupada's contribution is another, what we would call, what, paradigm shift, huh? It's a whole level above this understanding of religion, the absolute truth, that from which everything is coming. So that's true for everybody in all time and all places and all circumstances. So we say that, you know, that these teachings from Veda, from Bhagavatam, from Bhagavad Gita, this is absolute truth. It's true for everybody. So it's not a matter of belief. If I believe I'm not the body or not, it's you know, you believe you're not the body, but we believe we are the body. So what's the difference? Well, it's not a matter of belief. There is a absolute truth. And, of course, there's many people that won't accept that. They just think, well, that's your belief. And they'll leave it at that. But from our perspective, this is the absolute truth, and it's true for everyone. And everyone would benefit greatly by appreciating and understanding this truth and how they, how they are related to that truth. Generally, people, they try to relate the world to themselves, right? They are the center of everything, and how they see this world is in relationship to them. Otherwise, we call this I and mine, right? How I'm the enjoyer, and this world is meant for my enjoyment, and I see it in relationship to me. This is my Maya. But the absolute truth is, everything is Krishna, everything belongs to Krishna, and everything is meant for Krishna's pleasure, including me. And the devotee, therefore, he learns to see the world in relationship to Krishna, in relationship to that absolute truth. Then this way he stays free from Maya. Maya, the illusion is what? I'm the enjoyer. I'm the proprietor. This is Maya. When we forget Krishna, when we leave Krishna out of the picture, then we can fall under that illusion. This is meant for my happiness. But the real state of affairs is that everything is Krishna and everything is meant for Krishna, including me. And when we keep Krishna in the picture, then we see everything properly, and we can stay free from this illusion. Ashram? You're talking about ashram? How valid ashram is? How valid what is?
Yeah, if it's okay to practice devotional service on that non-varanashram situation.
This is going on the internet, yeah?
Yeah.
Do you have a microphone, or do I have to repeat the question for internet and everybody in radio land? Okay. So, I'm not very good at this. Let me see if I can do it. Say that you're asking for the concept of an ashram for people who are not living in an ashram, in a temple.
Not in a brahmachari ashram or not in a grihastha ashram.
Okay, not in a brahmachari ashram or a grihastha ashram. What about those people in terms of an ashram?
Yeah, what is the status? What is their status and what is their, how can they practice devotional service?
Yeah, of course this is a, when we say vanashram, this means an entire culture. So it's difficult to give just a brief answer to such a question. The first of all, ashram. Ashram means different stages of life. And those stages can be arranged in such a way so that every stage brings us closer to Krishna. So this is the traditional concept of ashram, and it doesn't matter specifically where you live. One can or cannot live in an ashram. So the grihastha ashram, we say, what's the difference between a grihastha and a grihamedi, is that the grihamedi is using their griha as a place of their own personal pleasure, whereas the grihastha lives always in Krishna's temple, in their home, whatever it is, their flat, they see it as Krishna's temple, and they live there as a servant of the deity. This way their home is an ashram, and all of their activities there in the home are devotional service. So the difference between material and spiritual is consciousness. There's the one thing that's material can also be spiritual. It's the consciousness with which it's used. So whether we live in an ashram or not in an ashram depends on the consciousness of the individual. Does that...
So some young men, they opt not to go into the Brahmacharya ashram, or they opt not to go into the Grihastha ashram, and just stay home and chant Hare Krishna.
Yeah, they're in the bachelor ashram. Those who don't go in the Brahmacharya ashram or the Grihastha ashram, what are they? They're in limbo. You know, the problem...
How do you advise
them? Well, the point is to come closer and closer to Krishna by whatever means one can. Okay, will you be able to come to class tonight? I don't want to give tonight's class now, but that's what I'm going to speak about tonight. Okay, I'll spill the beans just a little bit. In 12th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna he's telling, you follow Bhakti Yoga. If you can't follow it, then work for me. If you can't do that, then give up some of the result of your work for me. If you can't do that, then meditate. If you can't do that, then cultivate knowledge. So this is basically the way that all of us come to devotional service. I mean, we get a book from somebody, we cultivate knowledge, spiritual knowledge. From that, then we begin to come to the temple. We engage in somebody engages us in devotional service or gives us some beads, tells us to chant. So we then begin to meditate. Then we start making some donation. And then we come to the temple, we start doing service, and then gradually, by that purification, then we're able to take up full-time bhakti yoga. So that's basically the process, and that's the same process in vanashram dharma. Only the setting would be different. I give the example of one temple president in Miami, Narhari Prabhu, from many, many years ago. And Miami temple, of course, is in a semi-tropical place, very nice outside. And Narhari was such a temple president that he could engage anybody. Anybody that couldn't fit into any other temple, they'd send him to Miami, and Narhari Prabhu could give them some service. Because they'd show up and say, got any prasadam? And they'd say, yeah, sure, we're going to have prasadam in about 3 hours. In the meantime, can you go over there and help plant those flowers over here, right? They had about 2 acres of land there at the temple. And so there's a lot of different kind of activities that ordinary people could do who weren't so much inclined for temple activity. And so he would have them dig holes or plant bushes or flowers and different kinds of things like that. And so by this, by working for Krishna, and this is what, for many people, that's what they know. They know work, right? They're not intellectuals, they're not, you know, perhaps interested in spiritual topics, but they know work because that's how they survive. So vanashram means to make arrangement by which people can work for Krishna. And by doing that, by giving up the result of their work for Krishna, they become purified. So in Bhagavad Gita, the Lord states, by a man's own work, he can become perfect. And this is how, by making that mental adjustment that I'm doing this for the Lord, or I'm giving up the result of my activity for the Lord. I'm working for the Lord. So this is what vanashram is, really. It's to create a situation, the social circumstances, and make the arrangement by which ordinary people have the opportunity to come closer to the Lord by by those means.
And they can become perfect just by doing that?
They can become purified by doing that?
Perfect.
Perfect. That's what Krishna says. Right? Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, by a man's own work he can become perfect. What does that mean? Yes, initially not following anything, huh? Like all of us. I mean, we're all perfect example, right? There was one time when we may have been following any of the principles, but we'd come to the temple, we'd engage in devotional service, and gradually, huh, we become perfect. So it's not that work alone, but that's the starting place. Huh? We start with that. So we start with whatever we can do, with whatever we understand. Depends on the person and their inclinations, of course. But however you want to define work, doing something for Krishna, giving the result of something for Krishna. Let me tell you about, can you help me? Tell you about my new book. Make a plug for my book. Change the Karma. This book is written for people who are out there in the street protesting that the world is not fair. Huh? That things should be better. We want the government to do something different. And they think that simply by marching in the street, that's going to be sufficient, right? So they go and they wave all their signs and so on. You can see it's just a small book. It's just written, it's connected also with a website, changethekarma.com. And the idea is to help people understand that there's more going on than meets the eye. That why do we have the politicians that we have? Why do we have such rascal leaders? Huh? If we go back, of course, those who have some years of experience, you go back 50, 60 years, there was a time when we had better government, when we had better economy, we had better situation. Why was that? Because we had better karma. Huh? We had better activities. More and more over the years, people have been led to, encouraged to engage in sinful activity. And the result of sinful activity is suffering. Pretty simple. You know, it's cause and effect. But most people don't make that association because the Judeo-Christian religions, they can't explain to them properly what is sin. They don't really have a definition. Why is a sin sin? Huh? Sin is sin because if I do something that's sinful, it's going to cause me to suffer later on. Very simple. It's cause and effect. Huh? So this Change of Karma book is meant to help them make that connection and then to lead them to Prabhupada's books and Krishna consciousness. So we printed, you know, I had this printed up. I got 600 of them shipped here very quickly because that there was going to be this big protest in Wales about the UN gathering for, what was that? Some last month or something. Anyway, so I got this book finished real quick and shipped up here. And we went to Wales, and there's nobody there. So, anyway, I've got 600 books to be distributed, and they're cheap. So, just a pound each, or whatever you can get, like that. And if anybody wants a packet of 10, we'll get a better price. Anyway, if anybody goes to I don't know if any of you go to those protest things, but if you do, it's a book. Parashuram Prabhu, yeah. Okay, we'll get them all, get them to take them. So, something else. General question about Krishna consciousness. Who's the oldest? Who's, yeah. Prabhupada wanted, okay, so the question is, what's the role of writing for devotees in ISKCON?
What's the role of a writer?
What's the role of a writer? Actually, Prabhupada wanted everybody to be a writer. Prabhupada encouraged everyone to write. He said, never mind, four lines. Every day you should write something. Because by writing, one gets a lot of realization. In my writing, I got many realizations that I would not otherwise have. Because writing causes you to think. When we talk, the words just kind of tumble out and, you know, and they're gone. And we're not able to reflect on them. But when you write something down, you can go back and look at it and see. So Prabhupada wanted everybody to write, first of all. And then the second thing is, we write books for the purpose of explaining this philosophy to people according to time, place, and circumstance. Just like I wrote this book because Prabhupada's books don't directly address the problems of modern era, right? You give somebody, you know, Beyond Birth and Death, or, you know, Chant and Be Happy, or Science of Self-Realization, and they can't make that connection between that book and what's going on in the world. Huh? So there's a class of books now that devotees have called bridge books, which help, you know, it's something that people can relate to that helps them to make that connection with a greater understanding of Krishna consciousness. So, you know, our acharyas, the books they've written, of course, are very very important, very significant in helping us actually come to the pinnacle of devotional service, to complete self-realization. So that work has more or less been done. It's not necessary to repeat what Rupa Goswami has already written. But rather, I'll give you an example from my own self. I wrote to Prabhupada when I was just a new devotee. And I just finished, I graduated from university with a master's degree in engineering. And I was a little puffed up with those credentials, so I wrote to Prabhupada and I asked him how I could use my scientific credentials in Krishna's service. And I suggested to make an experiment because Bhagavad Gita explains that the moonshine, the effect of the moon is to actually make the fruits and vegetables very succulent and tasty. So I suggested an experiment that we could do like that. For the purpose, my stated purpose, was to convince the scientists of the validity of Bhagavad Gita. In Prabhupada's reply, you can see in the database, it's a letter to Bhaktadan, December 1, 1973. Prabhupada wrote, he said, we're not interested in convincing the scientists of anything, because after all, they have free will. And if they choose to remain atheistic, what can we do? He said, our main aim is to convince the innocent public that life comes from life and not from matter. He said, you just prove this and it'll be a very great victory. So Prabhupada wanted this writing, or, you know, the writing or preaching to be done for the benefit of the public, to help them understand the absolute truth. So in whatever way, according to one's background or one's interest, then one can take the philosophy of Krishna consciousness and explain it to people so that the innocent people can understand. So, and this is very much needed. You know, there's, of course, today there's unlimited literature, right? Just in your phone or on your, you know, your device, as they call it now, or, you know, your computer, with the internet. Before, like if you read Bhakti Vikash Maharaj, he wrote a nice little book called Glimpses of Traditional Indian Life. Anybody read that? Everybody should read this book. It's really helpful to understand how society functions in Krishna consciousness and how it changes over time. In this book is a... he interviews a number of ISKCON devotees who grew up in India and their childhood in India, and what things were like then, and then how things have changed in the last 50 years. And one can see that from in their childhood, that everybody, that there wasn't all this, you know, millions of things to hear about. You know, in their childhood, they would go to the temple at the end of the day and they would hear Ramayana or Mahabharata. And that's the same story that everybody knew. So they had a very cohesive culture because of that. Everybody understood things in more or less the same way. In today's society, everybody hears everything differently. I mean, And so that there's no way that they can communicate or even understand each other. We've come together because why? Because we've all shared in the experience of reading Srila Prabhupada's books. And so this gives us a common basis for understanding the world and how the world is supposed to work. And without that, everybody's got their own crazy idea of what things will be and what the future could be or whatever. So it's just too much, because people, they don't have the ability to accommodate all these different ideas and to integrate them in a way that's healthy and beneficial. So a place of pilgrimage for crows, as the Bhagavatam calls this, all these other literatures, just a place of pilgrimage for crows. But the Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charitamrita, these are for the swan-like devotees who can take the essence, the nectar of something. And it gives a cohesive understanding of what the reality is, to the point where when we read other kinds of literatures, we just see it as a disturbance. It doesn't actually help. It actually takes away from the understanding. So therefore, devotee, as they as they come closer to Krishna, either they focus more and more on that, or for people who are doing some outside preaching, what's necessary first is to get a well-grounded, well-developed foundation in the philosophy of Krishna consciousness. And then when you see the world, you relate what's going on in the world to that, to our philosophy. Then you don't have a chance of falling in Maya. But if you try to relate our philosophy to what's going on in the world, then you become all confused. Understand this point? This is a very important point. People will do that. For example, they read Bhagavad Gita and they say, well, I couldn't make any sense out of that book. Why? Krishna says very plainly, never is there a time when I did not exist, nor you, nor all these kings, nor in the future shall any of us cease to be. Pretty simple, right? Unless you're trying to relate that Bhagavad Gita, that verse, to your experience. And you say, no, at one time I was a child, now I'm a grown man, someday my grandfather, he died, so this Bhagavad Gita doesn't make any sense. If we try to relate the Gita, the Bhagavatam, to our worldly understanding, we won't make any sense. So rather we have to understand first Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, understand this truth, and then see everything in relationship to that, then we can understand things properly. So essential first to get that foundation in place, and then one can look at science or what's going on in the world, whatever, and see where the fault lies, because they see it in relationship to the absolute truth. Okay? Are you a writer? Okay, yeah. 2 lines, 4 lines. Every day, write something. Yeah. Having a better leader? Yeah. So the question is, he's asking about the change of the karma book, that having a better leader would make things different. Yes, of course.
It's like a fast track.
Yeah. So, but here's the point of the book, is to say that it's not just by marching in the street we're going to get a better leader. We get the leader that we deserve, actually, the way the world works. If we want a better leader, we have to be better people. Right? So it's easy to complain, oh, Cameron's this or that, or, you know, all those guys, Obama, all those, you know. Yeah, you just complain and point the finger at them, but the finger should be pointing here. What am I like? So that's the point. We have individual karma, and we have collective karma also, that as a nation, as a world, we're creating the world that we live in. We're making a dirty place. We're spoiling it by our activities, by our sinful activities. And so if we want a better world, we have to be better people. Well, there's no two ways about that. It's not that we can behave any way we want on this part of life and expect some nice life over here. Doesn't work like that. Even it may look like that for some time, all these rich guys, you know, who behave in any decadent way, and it seems like they have the whole world. Well, that's only one short life, right? And if we see after that, like the story of Ajamil, things will look very different in the next life. Who are these people that are being born in these terrible places on the earth? Why are they being born there? What were they like in the last life that caused them to take a birth there? So karma is a universal principle. It's very, very important to understand this karma and how it works. And if we want a better world, it's very simple. We simply have to change ourselves. That's where we have to work.
The reason I mentioned, because taking an example of Narendra Modi in India.
Yeah.
Yeah. Lot of negatives to positive.
Yeah. So he's giving the example of Narendra Modi in India. And that people have a lot of hope for Modi as a prime minister now. And I wrote on my Facebook page some time back that my opinion is that why does India have a good leader now? Because Krishna consciousness is strong in India. That's my opinion. And I give the example of America. In the 60s, when Srila Prabhupada came, America had a lot of, it's actually pretty much like it is now. A lot of social strife, a lot of problems. The war was going on, Vietnam War. The people were unhappy. They were protesting. So Prabhupada came into those circumstances in 1965. By the time, so we built up Krishna consciousness very strong in America at that time. They thought we had 1 million devotees or more because they'd see the devotees on every street corner chanting Hare Krishna all the time. And as a result of our chanting, as a result of our devotional service there, America, all these problems that were there in the 60s, by the time Prabhupada left this world, they were gone. But now, unfortunately, Krishna consciousness is not strong in America. And so the same situation has come back. So it's a very good example. Now we see the same thing even in Russia, right? That Putin, right? They don't allow any obscenity, any cursing or nudity in movies that are made in Russia or shown in the theater. There's no advertising, public advertising signboards for alcohol or cigarettes. And they're trying to actually lift the people up. And again, I say this is because Krishna consciousness is strong in Russia. And we can do the same thing here. Prabhupada says it doesn't require a lot of people. If 1% of the people, 2% will take up Krishna consciousness, it's enough to change the whole world. So that should be our goal. Get 1%. How many people are in London? Find out how many people live here. And your goal is get 1% of them to chant Hare Krishna. In the back of the book, I say here, actually, we want to have a change the karma campaign. How are we going to change the karma? To get everybody on the planet, or at least, the goal is, target is 1 billion people to wake up every day and chant the Hare Krishna mantra one time. That's all. You don't have to change anything else. Don't have to change your religion. Don't have to change your job. Don't have to give anything up. Wake up every day and chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. That's all. If 1 billion people will do that, it'll change everything. The problem is, this is too simplistic. And people think, come on, what? You have some hocus pocus, you don't really believe that, do you? Yeah, actually we do. It's a fact, And we have our own experience, right? This chanting Hare Krishna has changed our own lives. We have that experience. We can see how it's changed us. And we therefore mean the demigods and the demons. And, one of their regular wars they're having, and the demigods are not doing so good. And so they say, well, what are we going to do? Let's go to Vishnu. and appeal to Vishnu. So that's the situation in the world today. It's becoming a hellish, crazy place. What are we going to do? Well, why not go to Vishnu? Chant Hare Krishna. And we see the story from the Bhagavatam. When the demigods get the blessing of the Lord, they still have to do the work. Yeah, it's not that they sit there. Arjuna had to fight also. But then they get the result. So the result will come, but we have to appeal to the Lord for his help, for his shelter, and put him into the picture. So in India, they're doing so many devotees. In ISKCON is very strong now in India. So we see a lot of nice positive changes. And let's push it more and more. Yeah, Prabhu.
Just following on from that, just wondering what your thoughts on this. A number of religions all say that the name is important. It's said the same, the Muslims say the same, Allah in Christianity. Uh-huh.
Yeah. So your question is, are other names of God as effective?
Because they come from other cultures rather than from different concepts.
Yeah. So any bona fide name of God will do. And there's so many people, it's not that, again, that we want to change, Muslims into Hindus. No, you can. There's 1,000 names of Allah. They can chant those names. What does it mean? It means the same thing. Allah, the most powerful, I think, right? Something like that. So this is Rama. Same. So different language people have for calling on God, but it's the intention. It's the intention behind the sound that actually gives it the power. It's the consciousness that changed material to spiritual. So it's that same consciousness or intention that's behind the sound, which actually attracts the attention of the Lord. Thank you. What time do we stop?
Half eight.
Okay, time to go then. All right, so thank you very much. And tonight we'll speak more about Vanashram Dharma. You know, there's a little bit of Anutama Prabhu in the North American GBC. They had a post on Dandavats talking about Vanashram. So we'll speak about some of those issues tonight and also explain Vanashram as Krishna explains it in Bhagavad Gita. So if you can, please join us. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada. What time? 6 o'clock, I think, yeah?
Yeah.
Srila Prabhupada ki.
Okay, thank you for the class. So we have some scores from yesterday. And Govinda's restaurant, we distributed to a minimum of 309 customers for 2,832 Lakshmi points. And in Radha's boutique yesterday, 3 books were distributed for 180 Lakshmi points. And on Sankirtan, Srila Prabhupada's Transcendental Book Distribution scores are as follows. Friday Harinam Party, 18 Lakshmi, 13 medium books for 6.5 book points. And Bhakta Sami, 24 Lakshmi, 9 medium books, 1 Mahabik for 6.5 book points. Srila Prabhupada ki. So we'll just ask for some volunteers to help serve prasadam today, please. One, two, any more?